بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم السلام علیکم ورحمت اللہ وبرکاتہ Welcome to the program known as Liqa Mal Arab, which is the most popular program of MTA. In this program, various Arab friends, they are present and they are going to wait the arrival of Hadhrat Amir al-Mumineen Ayyadahullah Ta'ala bin Asli Aziz so that he can answer to their questions. In the meantime, we are instructed to start the program, and I would like to request Brother Munir Ode to kindly welcome the viewers and also give us the Arabic translation of that part of the answer which he could not do last time because of the shortage of time. Would you please start?
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Mushahideen al-Kiram. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullahi
wa barakatuh. الآن بالترجمة لما تبقى من كلام حضرة أمير المؤمنين في الحلقة السابقة ردا على سؤال حضرة الأخ أبو حسين المتعلق بالبرهان البراهين من القرآن الكريم على صدق سيدنا أحمد عليه الصلاة والسلام فردا على ذلك قال أمير المؤمنين أن أول آية أنزلت إلى الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم دليلا على صدقه كانت فقد لبثت فيكم عمرا من قبله أفلا تعقلون أي لقد أمضيت فيكم عمرا طويلا من قبل أفلا يوجد لديكم ذرة من المنطق والعقل فهذا برهان على صدق كل نبي ليس للرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم فقط وذلك قبل الدعوة وقبل إعلانهم على أنهم مبعوثين من قبل الله سبحانه وتعالى وأما بعد ذلك فيتهمون بالكذب ولكن الأربعين سنة التي مضاها الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم في قومه منذ طفولته وصباه وبعد ذلك في كل هذه الأربعين سنة لم يجد أي شخص أي عيب في شخصية الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم لم يكذب أبدا ولم يتهم حتى بذلك فالبرهان هو أنه فيقول المؤمنين عن الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم أنه هل جن أو ماذا حدث له لأربعين سنة عاش رسول صلى الله عليه وسلم في قومه ويعرفون أنه لم يكذب أبدا من قبل فلذلك فلماذا يتحول فجأة إلى كاذب كهذا وأن يفتري على الله الكذب هذا البرهان ينطبق أيضا على سيدنا أحمد عليه الصلاة والسلام لقد عاش سيدنا أحمد عليه الصلاة والسلام أربعين سنة أو ما يعادل ذلك بين أهله وقومه في الهند آنذاك عمل معهم جلس معهم وعاش حياة طبيعية معهم وكان معروفا لدى الجميع ولم يجد أحد أي تهمة يوجهها إلى حضرة سيدنا أحمد عليه الصلاة والسلام بالخيانة أو بالكذب أو أنه قام بأعمال مخالفة للتعاليم الإسلامية وحتى تلك اللحظة التي ادعى فيها على أنه مبعوث من الله سبحانه وتعالى فعندها قامت الاتهامات ولو كان هنالك أي شيء يذكر ضده فلا بد وأن واجهه قومه آنذاك باتهامه وعرض تلك الاتهامات أمامه فلماذا أهل ذلك الوقت لم ينشروا ذلك معلنين عما قام به هذا الرجل خلال حياته أو جاءوا بالبراهين التي تصدق قولهم على أنه قام بتلك الأعمال وحتى في يومنا هذا إذا قرأنا بعض المنشورات المطبوعة من قبل جهات معادية للجماعة الإسلامية الأحمدية لن نجد هنالك أي برهان لديهم ليشيروا على أن المسيح الموعود عليه الصلاة والسلام كان كاذبا ويقولون أنه ولو كان ذلك صحيحا فلا بد وأن قالوا أنه كان كذابا وكانت عنده عادة الكذب فهذا الادعاء كان من إحدى تلك الأكاذيب فلو كان هذا القانون أو هذه القاعدة سارية للمفعول على جميع الأنبياء الذين سبقوه فلا بد وأن تكون قاعدة لفحص صدق سيدنا أحمد عليه الصلاة والسلام وحجة له كذلك فلماذا لنا ولكم أن تفرقوا بينه وبين غيره من الأنبياء وذكر في القرآن الكريم عن سيدنا صالح عليه الصلاة والسلام أنك كنت مرجوا فيهم لقد كان سيدنا الصالح عليه الصلاة والسلام مرجوا لدى الناس ولدى قومه، وفجأة تحول إلى كاذب. هذا البرهان ليس بسيطا كما يرى لأول وهلة، فإنه برهان وقاعدة عامة في نواحي مختلفة من الحياة. فرجل الذي يصل سن 40، حيث يبدأ سن الشيخوخة وانتهاء فترة سن الشباب، فقبل ذلك يمر المرء في مشاكل ومصاعب وشهوات وغيرها، فإذا وقف صامدا أمام كل تلك المصاعب والمشاكل فلا بد وأن يكون ذو شخصية قوية. فلو كذب أو خدع فالجميع سوف يعرف ذلك وأنها ستقف حجة ضده. فالقرآن الكريم لا يذكر عنه إذا كان صادقا أم كاذبا فقط، وإنما يذكر عنه كإنسان بشكل عام في النواحي المختلفة والحالات المختلفة في الحياة، كما ذكر عن الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم بأنه لقب الصادق الأمين وغيرها من الصفات الحسنة. فهذه القاعدة تنطبق على سيرة سيدنا أحمد عليه الصلاة والسلام، حيث عاش في القاديان بين الجميع، والجميع كانوا يعرفونه لأنه أباه كان شخصا معروفا آنذاك في تلك المنطقة، ويروى عنه دائما أنه كان يجول ويصطحب الفقراء من الصبية، وأنه كان يتقاسم طعامه معهم، وكان يكتفي بأكل الحمص أو ما شابه ذلك عوضا عن طعامه. فمرة جاء هندوسيا إلى بيت أبيه وقال: إنني أرى أولادك جميعا وأعرفهم، ولكنني لم أرى ابنك الذي يدعى ميرزا غلام، فأين هو؟ فإنني لم أراه أبدا، ولكن سمعت عنه فقط. فقال أباه: حسنا، إذا تريد أن تلقاه فاذهب إلى المسجد، فلربما ستجده ملفوفا بإحدى السجاجيد أو الحصار في المسجد، فهو يعيش هنالك ولا يهتم بأي شيء. وفعلا أن سيدنا أحمد عليه الصلاة والسلام لم يهتم بأي شيء مادي ودنيوي، بل كان يتلو القرآن دائما، وكان يحب دراسة الأديان عامة، وقد درس المسيحية والبوذية والهندوسية وغيرها. ولقد أمضى حياته في تجهيز نفسه وتحضير نفسه للدفاع عن الإسلام، فلماذا لرجل كهذا أن يبدأ الكذب ويدعي أنه مبعوث الله؟ فلو كان ذلك صحيحا فإنه أحقر إنسان على الأرض، وكما ذكر في القرآن الكريم: ومن أظلم ممن افترى على الله الكذب. فلو كان كاذبا فلماذا عليه أن يعاني من أجل ذلك الكذب؟ فالإدعاء هو شيء، وكيفية تقبل المجتمع لهذا الإدعاء هذا شيء آخر، كما ذكر في الآية في الآية التي تلوناها: أن جميع الأنبياء أمضوا حياة طيبة وعندها اشتهروا وأصبحوا مرجوين في قومهم، حتى تلك اللحظة التي أمروا على أنهم مرسلين من قبل الله سبحانه وتعالى، ففي اليوم التالي يخسرون كل اشتهارهم وسمعتهم. فسأل أمير المؤمنين ويتساءل: فهل للإنسان أن يكذب كي يشتهر أم كي يخسر كل شهرته؟ فالكاذب دائما يقوم بذلك للحصول على شيء، وليس للخسارة. وهذا هو البرهان الآخر الذي يدعم ادعاء وصدق جميع الأنبياء. فالرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم قام بتكفيره الجميع في البداية باستثناء عدة أشخاص كأبو بكر وعلي رضي الله عنهم، فوراءه لم يكن أي شيء لينقذه، بل كان عليه أن يدخل غابة مرعبة وأن يتصدى لما يكون فيها وحده، وكيف أنه سيصمد أمام جيش بأكمله؟ فلو لم يكن هنالك أي أحد ينقذه أو يدعمه فلعرف ذلك بنفسه ولارتد عن ذلك، ولكنه قال أنه: لا يهمني شيء، افعلوا ما شئتم، فإنني أنا سأكون صاحب النصر. وانظروا كذلك إلى المسيح الناصري عليه الصلاة والسلام، أي دعامة كانت لديه وأي قوة! كم من الصيادين اتبعوه وبايعوه، كانوا أقل من 30، ولكنه لم يخشى أحد وقال: افعلوا ما شئتم، فأنا سأكون صاحب النصر. وانظروا إلى المسيحية اليوم في أنحاء منتشرة في جميع أنحاء المعمورة. فهذا هو النبأ الثاني الذي يمكن أن يقاس به أي نبي يأتي إلى هذه الأرض. فإن هؤلاء الأشخاص هم الذين يعلنون على أنهم أصحاب النصر، وبالرغم من أن لم يمكن تصديقهم لا يمكن لأي أحد تصديقهم على أنهم الذين سوف ينتصرون في بداية الأمر لضعفهم ولنبذ جميع الناس ولترك الناس هذا الشخص. وهذا ما ادعاه سيدنا أحمد عليه الصلاة والسلام، حيث أن الجميع تركه ولكنه قال: إن الناس تركوني ولكن الله سبحانه وتعالى لم يتركني، وقال: أنا لم أتركك وإني سأنشر دعوتك إلى أقصى أطراف الأرضين. فانظروا اليوم إلى ذلك الشخص الذي تحمل الكثير في القاديان وكان وحيدا، حتى وأن عائلته تركته ونبذته، ولكن قال الله سبحانه وتعالى له ووعده بأنه سيبلغ دعوته إلى أقصى أطراف الأرضين. فانظروا إلى هذه القناة MTA، القناة الإسلامية الوحيدة والفريدة من نوعها في عالم الإسلام، التي خصصت لنشر الدعوة ولنشر الإسلام. وعلى الرغم من أننا جماعة فقيرة نسبيا، فهنالك الكثير من الأموال تحت أقدام ملوك النفط.
MashaAllah, you're doing very well, huh? Learning fast. Sure, please continue.
وزاد أمير المؤمنين قائلا: على أن هنالك الأموال الكثيرة والجبال من الأموال التي تحت أقدام ملوك النفط، وأنهم لم يستطيعوا القيام بذلك. وصوت ذلك الشخص البسيط ميرزا غلام أحمد القادياني منتشر إلى جميع أطراف المعمورة، فأي كاذب يكون هذا؟ فهنالك آية أخرى في القرآن الكريم التي تتحدث عن ذلك المدعي البسيط في أول طريقه والعداء المضاد له من قومه، والبرهان هو كما ذكر: أفلا يرون أن نأتي الأرض ننقصها من أطرافها أفهم الغالبون؟ أفلا ترون أنكم أنتم تملكون المساحات الكثيرة والعقارات الكبيرة، فعندما تصطدمون بذلك المدعي فإن أرضكم تصغر وهو يحصل على الأرض، وأن أرضكم تبقى وتصغر شيئا فشيئا. أفأنتم الغالبون؟ أفمثل هؤلاء الناس سيكونون الغالبون؟ فها نحن تحدينا جميع الأديان مدافعين عن الإسلام، ففي الأحمدية سترون تحقق النبأ الذي ذكر في القرآن الكريم، حيث يقول: هو الذي أرسل رسوله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله. ومن الذي يقوم بالتضحيات؟ فليست تلك الأموال التي تؤخذ من الأغنياء فقط، بل التي تجمع من الناس جميعا. فليس صدق ذلك المدعي وحده هو البرهان على صدقه، بل صدق أتباعه أيضا هو برهان آخر، وذلك عن طريق تضحياتهم، حيث ذكر في القرآن الكريم: إن الله اشترى من المؤمنين أنفسهم وأموالهم بأن لهم الجنة. فلماذا يدعو الله تعالى المؤمنين إلى مثل هذه الصعوبات والابتلاء؟ فلو كان أولئك الأشخاص الذين استجابوا لنداء الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم كانوا غير صادقين، فلما ضحوا وقدموا ما كان لديهم من عقار وسيادة. هذه إشارة أخرى لصدق ذلك المدعي. فلولا أن اتباع ميرزا غلام أحمد آنذاك فلو أن أتباع ميرزا غلام أحمد آنذاك قدمت لهم بعض المبالغ أو العقارات، فلما آمنت به، لأن ذلك لم يحصل في تاريخ الأنبياء والمرسلين جميعا. فإذا اتبعت رجلا مبعوثا من الله سبحانه وتعالى، فعلينا أن نمر بأشياء بأقصى المعاملات، حيث أننا نرجم بالحجارة، حتى أن أهلنا يتركوننا وينبذوننا وأننا نعامل بأقسى المعاملات، فكيف لرجل أن يتحمل ذلك لولا أن رأى الحق؟ فهذا هو البرهان الآخر. فهل هذا لم يحصل للمسيح الموعود عليه الصلاة والسلام؟ وهذا ما يحدث حتى في يومنا هذا في الباكستان وغيرها من الأماكن، مما يكلف الجماعة في بعض الأحيان بالحياة وفي بعض الأحيان أخرى بالكثير من المصاعب لاتباعهم سيدنا أحمد عليه الصلاة والسلام. فيقول أمير المؤمنين هذا ما ذكر عن أصحاب الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم، فإما أن يكونوا صادقين أو مجانين، فإن الكفار لم يقبلوا أنهم كانوا صادقين، فلذلك دعوا بالمجانين. وكذلك ما نراه في أيامنا هذا تجاه الجماعة الإسلامية الأحمر.
Why Majanin? Explain this. Because it's only a madman who doesn't know where his benefit lies, where his advantages lie, from which things he profits. So he loses his things right and left, and no sense of possession left. So such things can occur only either from the top righteous people, who are the summit of righteousness, who see things beyond, who see the face of God, and for that face they sacrifice all they possess. Or just madmen do that. Any man with sanity will not sacrifice his things for nothing. And what things? Honor, property, wealth, life, the dear ones, the families, the tribes, all are lost. So there can be no other answer than this. Either these people have to be right and true people, or they have to be mad. So the first option they wouldn't accept. So they took the second option as the only alternative option. Otherwise, this is a dilemma which can't be solved, right?
There's a comment that he says here in your last time. I didn't see it in the video, that Sayyidina Salih alayhi salam, he turned to be a liar. Did you say that?
No, I didn't.
He said
He must have said something which was misunderstood or misconveyed.
Or misinterpreted.
That's right, that's possible. But we'll rectify it. Tell them. Please.
لقد ذكر أمير المؤمنين وطلب أن نشرح لماذا المجانين. فقال أمير المؤمنين إن لأي شخص عادي عاقل لا يمكن أن يخسر وأن يذهب بأمواله وعائلته وعزته لأي سبب، فإما أن يكون من أتقى الناس لأنه يرى في المستقبل وأنه يعرف من الله سبحانه وتعالى ما لا يعرفه الناس العاديين، أو إما أن يكون مجنونا والذي ليس له أي منطق. فيقول أمير المؤمنين ذلك أن هؤلاء الناس لم يقبلوا الإمكانية الأولى، ولا أن يكون صادقا وتقيا، فلهذا يجب أن يقبلوا وأن يتهموا ذلك الشخص بالجنون.
That is exactly what they say about Hadhrat Masih-e-Maud alayhi salam. He's Majnoon, madman. But all the previous prophets were also called madmen. Please.
يقول أمير المؤمنين أن هذا ما ذكر عن سيدنا أحمد عليه الصلاة والسلام بأنه كان رجلا مجنونا وأن لم يكن لديه ذرة من العقل، وهذا ما اتهم به جميع الأنبياء من قبله وجميع المرسلين.
Now the blame that somebody is majnoon or mad is not tenable in this case, in the case of the prophets, not at all, because they speak of such wisdom as they challenge the world around. If you can bring something to be compared with what I tell you of wisdom, come and show me, and they fail to do it. And moreover, they cannot be declared to be false people for this, doing this for the sake of anything else. Because the best a prophet could require would be honor. For the, you know, some people are mad for an in their ambition to become the leaders. But when they claim, they do not get leadership. They destroy leadership they already had gained previously. They are supposed to be the very leaders. You mentioned Hazrat Saleh.
Yes.
And Hazrat Saleh it was who was told, addressed by his people, Marjuvan Fina, Kunta Marjuvan Fina. That you were the one with in whom we lay high expectations, who was supposed to be the one, the leader which is emerging from us. So he rejected that leadership. So that is why there is no logic either way. If he is a cunning man, even a cunning man can sacrifice things for the sake of great honor or fulfillment of his ambition to gain leadership. That does not apply to the case of the prophets. Because they are leaders of a sort, accepted by the people, respected by the people around. Before they claim, when they claim, all the leadership goes overboard and they are deprived of that honor which they had gained first. So it is impossible to prove a prophet wrong. If he is a true prophet, these are the signs which go with him.
لقد ذكر أمير المؤمنين أن هؤلاء الأنبياء أو المبعوثين يأتون بحكمة معهم فإن الجميع فإن هؤلاء الناس يكونون مرجوين في ومحترمين قبل ادعائهم وأن أكثر شيء مهما لدى النبي هو الحصول على احترامه والحصول على المقام ولكن عند ادعائهم يخسرون كل ما حصلوا عليه من شهرة واحترام وكما ذكرنا فيما قبل عن حضرة صالح عليه الصلاة والسلام حيث ذكر في القرآن أنك كنت مرجوا فيهم
قالوا يا صالح قد كنت فينا مرجوا
فينا
قالوا يا صالح قد كنت فينا مرجوا قبل هذا before you made this claim you were مرجوا with the claim no more so this is a positive proof that the prophets have no ambition
وكما ذكر في الآية على أن سيدنا صالح عليه الصلاة والسلام كان مرجوا فيهم قبل دعوته وأنه مبعوث من الله سبحانه وتعالى ويقول أمير المؤمنين أن شخصا كاذبا لن يقوم بذلك أو بتلك التضحيات التي يقوم بها جميع الأنبياء ويقول أمير المؤمنين ولربما سيقوم بتلك التضحيات للحصول على شهرة أو على الحصول على الاحترام ولكنه لن يقوم بذلك والسيادة أيضا ولكنه لن يقوم بذلك لخسارة تلك الشهرة والسيادة
Now this can be demonstrated in case of Hazrat Aqdas Sayyidina Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when Quraish did everything they could to dissuade him from propagation of the unity of God propagation of Islam At last, they made a delegation and they came to Hazrat Abu Talib and told him that, look here, we are now fed up with this. This must be decided either way. Tell your nephew that if he wants shura, honor and fame and glory, we are ready to give him the leadership of Mecca. If he wants the most beautiful girl in Arabia, we promise we'll provide him that. If he wants wealth, whatever he wants, we are going to offer him with respect and accept him as our leader. But he must dissuade from the propagation of unity of God. When Hazrat Abu Talib approached Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and told him, oh my nephew, I give you shelter and I also suffer. Today my people came to me with this message And they said, Abu Talib, is enough is enough, no more. I will be with you, I will not abandon you, but you know, it's how difficult it is becoming. So this is their offer. What's your answer? He said, as far as you are concerned, I am not protected by you, I am protected by my God. Forget about this, that you are giving me protection. As far as their offer is concerned, tell them that if they bring the sun and put it on my right hand, and they bring the moon and put it on my left hand, I will chuck them away and I care not for them. But unity is my profession, my obsession, my love. I can never abandon unity of God. So therein lies the proof of his honesty and total, absolute dedication to truth. Yet they wouldn't understand. The blind people don't see.
لقد ذكر أمير المؤمنين مشيرا إلى الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم حيث أن قريش حاولوا دائما منعه وإغراءه للتوقف عن دعواه عن وحدانية دعواه لوحدانية الله سبحانه وتعالى حيث أنهم جاءوا أبا طالب يوم من الأيام وقالوا أننا لا نستطيع أن نأخذ ذلك أن نسكت على ما يدعيه قريبك فيجب أن نحسم الأمر اليوم قبل غد فقالوا له لو أراد الشهرة والاحترام سنعطيه سيادة مكة ولو سنعطيه ونأتي به ونأتي له بأجمل امرأة إذا كان يريدها ولكن عليه ترك وحدانية الله سبحانه وتعالى ودعوته إليها
and abuse of our idols they also said that we should stop abusing our idols rejecting them
وأن يهين آلهتنا فقال أبو طالب أن فدخل أبو طالب على رسول صلى الله عليه وسلم وقال له هذا ما يعرضه عليك أهل قريش فإنك تحت حمايتي وأنا لا أتركك ولكن ما هو رأيك فقال بالنسبة لحمايتك لي فعليك أن تعرف أنني ليس تحت حمايتك وإنما أنا تحت حمية الله سبحانه وتعالى وأما بالنسبة لعرضهم فإنني أقول لو وضعوا الشمس على يميني والقمر على يساري فلن أتخلى عن وحدانية الله سبحانه وتعالى فهنالك نستطيع أن نرى صراحة وصدق سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى الرغم من ذلك فإن هؤلاء الكفار لم يستطيعوا أن يروا ذلك آنذاك.
Now coming to the question of their allegation that the claimant to prophethood is mad. Their attitude proves them to be absolutely false or mad themselves. Because when madmen say things, people never take them seriously. Look, scan the whole history of man and his behavior. When madmen rave and do this and that, people don't take them seriously. They laugh at them. Children stone them, but children only. And they are never confronted because they are never taken seriously. He's a madman, you know. They laugh at them and mock at them and that's all. And they never grow. I have never read about a madman gathering strength from strength and people after people and tribe after tribe joining his forces, joining forces with him. Madmen remain madmen alone and single and abandoned. So why do they take prophets of Allah so seriously if they are madmen? They have no logic.
They call him even Shairun or Magnun.
Shairun, that is the same thing. Shair means shair liar. Shair here is means liar and a Majnun. But why do you take them seriously? What was there about Jesus, for instance? What did he do to offend them? If he was, his preaching was only that of forgiveness. How could a preaching of forgiveness and love offend anybody in the world? So by rejecting the mad him, all of the prophets, they proved themselves to be mad. Because they had no logic in that. in real madmen, they believed. Even today, believe in a sense that some people who are mad and they say, we can do this and we can bring you, people go and say Assalamu Alaikum and try to gain some favor from him, as if he is the Lord of the universe. But madmen are never opposed, tooth and nail, like the prophets of Allah are opposed. And madmen, if opposed, will be completely wiped out and destroyed. They have no strength. There are some cases where some people who were supposed to be mad, they were opposed, and they were beaten down and flattened to earth. Nothing is heard of them. But prophets of God, none can touch them. It's impossible. They grow from strength to strength and glory to glory. This is not the behavior of madmen, is there? Certainly not.
لقد قال أمير المؤمنين أن ادعاء النبوة دائما أن من يدعي بالنبوة دائما لقب بالجنون فهو معروف فانظروا إلى التاريخ فلا أحد ينظر إلى مجنون بأي أهمية أو جدية فلماذا فعندما يأتي أي نبي يتهم بالجنون ولكن مع ذلك يؤخذ بأكثر جدية وباهتمام كبير فيقول أمير المؤمنين بأن أي مجنون بسيط لا يمكن أن يجمع قواه ويجمع أتباعه شيئا فشيئا فإن المجنون العادي فإنه مجنون ويبقى مجنونا ولا أحد يهتم إليه سوى الأطفال الصغار فانظروا إلى المسيح الناصري عليه الصلاة والسلام اتهموه دعواه كانت المحبة والعفو بينما عودي من جميع الناس وقيل عنه أنه مجنون فإن الناس يؤمنون بالمجانين ويذهبون إلى هذا الشخص وذلك الشخص وينحنون أمامه فإن المجنون العادي لا يعاني كما يعانيه أنبياء الله سبحانه وتعالى فإن المجنون لا قوة له ولا أحد يستطيع أن يقف دعما له فإذا
he does not gain strength as he progresses.
فإذا قام أي مجنون بادعاء شيء فإن إذا واجهه الناس فسيقضون عليه ولا يتكون لديه أي قوة ولا يحصل على قوة ولا تزداد قوته بعد ذلك.
Another thing about this process is that Majnoon people or the false prophets, they're two different categories. The Majnoon are left alone and not cared for. What about the false prophets? The false prophets are not opposed by the people. They have a backing of a tribe. They have a backing of a gang. They conspire first and come out in the form of a strong band and armed people, and they claim to be representatives of God, these false people, always with the help of a tribe or some powerful group behind them. Now look at the history of the Mutanabbiyin for Islam. They're always, without fail, supported by a clan, a tribe, or another powerful group behind them, and who wanted to gain some ulterior motives out of their claim. But what of them? How can we recognize them then? Because they are not madmen. One can know they are clever, cunning people, they are not madmen. What would happen to them? On that subject, the Holy Quran says, referring to another sign of the truth of Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَلَوْ تَقَوَّلَ عَلَيْنَا بَعْضُ الْأَقَابِيلِ لَأَخَذْنَا مِنْهُ بِالْيَمِينِ ثُمَّ لَقَطَعْنَا مِنْهُ الْوَتِينَ فَمَا مِنْكُمْ مِنْ أَحَدٍ عَنْهُ حَاجِزِينَ. If he were a conscious liar and imposter who concocted things and himself and attributed them to me falsely, how can people know that this man has not been spoken to by God. Everyone who claims, how do we know, how can we know? We are not sitting in between the he and a person. So this is the dilemma. Should we accept such a man? Should we reject him? What is our responsibility? Should we oppose him? Should we try to punish him and destroy him? Then all these questions arise. One of them is answered in this verse, which says, you have nothing to do with it. We have. He has attributed lies to us, not to you. If this prophet had attributed lies to you, then you could punish him. But he hasn't. You know he has been Amin, you know he has been Siddiq or Suduq, and all these praises he has won from you. So, all right, you say he has spoken against us, a lie, a fabrication. We must punish, and we will. Just wait and see. لَوْ تَقَبَّلَ عَلَيْنَا بَعْضَ الْأَقَاوِيلِ. Not to talk of the whole Quran. If we had concocted even a few sayings attributing them to us, لَأَخَذْنَا مِنْهُ بِالْيَمِينِ, we would have caught him by the right hand. ثُمَّ لَقَطَعْنَا مِنْهُ الْوَتِينِ, and then we would have severed his life artery. فَمَا مِنْكُمْ مِنْ أَحَدٍ أَنْهُ حَاجِزِينَ, there would be none then from among you to support him and prevent the wrath of Allah to befall him. None could stand between Allah's wrath and him. Now this presents a beautiful scenario of which I have already spoken. The false people have the support of false people with them. But when Allah's wrath befalls them, none can stop it. It's the other way around with the righteous people. They are left alone, abandoned, at the mercy of any Tom, Dick and Harry to do them any harm they like. But it is Allah who stands between them and that man and protects him. So it is exactly the opposite scenario which is built in the case of true prophets. Got it?
فيقول أمير المؤمنين هنالك نوعان من الذين يلقبون, فهم المجانين وهنالك أيضا المدعين الكاذبين. فيقول أمير المؤمنين إلا المجانين العاديين يتركون دون أي اهتمام أو دون أي جدية, وأما المدعين الكاذبين فإنهم يخططون قبل ادعائهم ويكون لديهم دعم من قبل فئة معينة من الناس وأنهم يخططون قبل ذلك. فيقول أمير المؤمنين تعالوا ننظر إلى تاريخ المتنبين في التاريخ, وأن ونستطيع أن نرى أنهم دائما يأتون ويظهرون مدعومين بقوة معينة أو من فئة معينة, وأنهم يريدون الحصول على سلطة أو أي عقار دنيوي ولسبب معين. فذكر في القرآن الكريم كآية لصدق رسول صلى الله عليه وسلم, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم, بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم, ولو تقول علينا بعض الأقاويل لأخذنا منه باليمين ثم لقطعنا منه الوتين.
فما منكم من أحد
عنه بحاجزين. فلو كان كاذبا اخترع ذلك المدعي أشياء من لدنه, فكيف سيعرف الناس إن كان ذلك النبي صادقا أم كاذبا؟ فهل فيتساءل الناس ويقولون عندها, هل يجب علينا أن نصدق ذلك الشخص؟ هل نتركه؟ أم هل نقتله؟ أم نعاديه كأي عدو لنا؟ وهنا نرى الإجابة, حيث يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى, هذا ليس شأنكم فإنه افترى شيئا علينا وهذا شأننا, فلو أنه كذب وافترى عليكم فهذا سيكون شأنكم. فكما ذكر في الآية حيث قيل, ولو تقول علينا بعض الأقاويل, أي إذا افترى بعض الأقاويل على الله سبحانه وتعالى لأخذنا منه باليمين, وأنه سيمسك الله سبحانه وتعالى بيمينه ثم لقطعنا منه الوتين وأنه سيقطع عنقه وأن عذاب no.
The life artery.
الوتين
No need of interest in الوتين yes.
ثم لقطعنا منه الوتين فما من أحد عنه بحاجزين
منكم
من أحد
عنه
حاجزين ولا أحد يستطيع أن يوقف ويرد عذاب الله سبحانه وتعالى النازل على ذلك المدعي الكذاب فإن المدعين الصادقين يتركون ويأتون دون أي دعم أو قوة ويكونوا تحت حمية الله سبحانه وتعالى وليس لهم سلطة دنيوية أخرى
No one stands between him and God to protect him. They all attack him. Who stands between? It is God who stands between him and his so-called destroyers, his enemies. And the case of the Mutanabiyyin is exactly the opposite.
It's in the history of...
That's right.
There is Mutanabiyyin before Hadhrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad.
Of course.
They call they were prophets and...
They claim to be prophets.
In what
Mutanabbi.
Century?
The first was... Kya naam tha uska pura? Aswad Ansi. Nahin, the pehla jisne Rasulullah Sallam ke saamne daawat kiya. Musalma.
Musalma al-Kazzab.
Musalma al-Kazzab was during the lifetime of Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. He was supported by his tribe and he came in as a delegation and sent the message to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam that I am also a prophet of God, so I have come with the proposition that we should share this office together. Let's divide this authority. Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam told his messenger that I do not care. क्या उठाया था दस दिन का स्ट्रॉ आई डू नॉट केयर फॉर इज ऑफर इवन टू द एक्सटेंट ऑफ दिस स्ट्रॉ टू द वेट ऑफ दिस स्ट्रॉ और टू द वैल्यू ऑफ दिस स्ट्रॉ टेल हिम गो बैक गॉड हैज अपॉइंटेड मी एंड दिस इज नॉट टू बी शेयर्ड
बट गॉड हैज प्रूव दैट दे वर लायर लाइक
दैट्स व्हाट आई एम सेइंग
बट एंड ही स्टॉप्ड दिस थिंग इन द कुरान एंड टेल हिम But about Mu'assid Jamal Ahmadiyya.
No, I'm coming to that. I'll come to that.
Because no time to talk.
No, we'll continue. next time, tomorrow, the day after. No,
because there's an important question I'll ask you today, please.
No problem. Just show patience, please.
I am.
Okay. we'll come tomorrow and the day after as well. I have started a subject which has to be covered entirely, exhausted.
Yeah.
Because there are many things which may arise in the minds of other viewers. When you ask a question, my address no longer remains confined to you.
No, to everybody.
Because it's not a private meeting.
No.
So all the viewers in the world are watching and listening. Yeah. So I have to satisfy all the possible queries which may arise in their hearts. That is why I take longer. So I'll turn to you in your turn. But you understand that the whole world is watching us.
Yes, indeed.
So I should...
And everybody wants to comment.
Exactly.
To say.
On their behalf, I am commenting myself, raising questions. This could be said, that could be said, that could be said, this is the answer to this, and that and that. This is a style of argumentation, please. Huh? So where was I? About... Musalma Kazab. And others like him, they were all supported by groups, gangs and tribes. In case of Hazrat Masih-e-Maud alayhi salatu wasalam, his image is absolutely opposite to that of the Mutanabiyyin, because he lost support of all who were behind him prior to his claim. Those who praised him began to abuse him. Those who were his friends, they began to hate him to the extent that they will become bloodthirsty enemies. This fate is not the fate of mutanabbiyin. This is only is the fate of the true prophets of Allah. But another thing which I wanted to tell you in relation to this issue which we are discussing is an aspect of the question which I raised and have not yet answered. Let me answer it. I said, if somebody claims to be from God, what should be your reaction? What should you do? You don't know him. You don't know whether God did speak to him or not. So leave him to God. He will most certainly take care of him. He will not let a liar prosper who has attributed false claims to Allah. This is the import of the whole verse. But there is another verse which says that if somebody goes on speaking of God, giving him a message and this and that, is it your responsibility to kill him, to destroy him? Is khatil mutanabbi, is what is advised by Allah? This is the question which is also to be sorted out. And now I turn to another verse of the Holy Quran which applies to the time of Moses, alayhi salam. The Holy Quran tells us that the elders of the time of Moses were together in conference. They were contemplating the murder of Hazrat Musa, alayhi salatu wasalam. Then a man from among them walked into that conference. He was inside, deep in his heart, he was a believer, but he was hiding this fact. But addressing them, he said, in yaku kaziban fa alayhi kazibu, in yaku kaziban fa alayhi kazibu wa in yaku sadiqan yusibkum ba'dhu allazi yu'idukum. Now this is a universal truth mentioned in this verse. Was he wrong or was he right? He says you are planning to murder him. But remember, if he is a liar, the responsibility of his lies does not rest on your shoulders. It rests on the shoulder of God. Because he is speaking a lie against him, not against you. But remember also, if he proved to be right, then whatever effort you make against him is going to turn against you. Then whatever he threatens you with, by the way of wrath of Allah, it is going to follow you and it will not leave you alone. It will be fulfilled. So both these are the criteria. Apply them to Hazrat Mirza Sahib and see for yourself what happened. Was he a madman? If he was a madman, he should have been left alone and he would destroy himself. Madmen do not need an enemy to destroy them. They commit a sort of suicide. There is no future for madmen. If he was a liar, then he was the greatest liar of his time. The one who attributed false claims to Allah. Where was this verse then, which said, leave him to me, I'll do it, I'll take care. What care did God take of this man, if he was a false man? When people said, you are a false prophet, you are not a true prophet, and we'll see to it that you are destroyed and demolished and completely annihilated from the face of earth. You know what he said? He said, all right, come on, do it. Bring all your forces, muster all your strength. Destroy me if you can, but God has told me, he stands behind me. None of you will ever see me destroyed. I'm going to spread and grow from strength to strength until he's told them that God has told me that my name will reach the corners of the earth. Was it a madman speaking or a false man speaking? Why don't you visualize yourself the situation in which he was. If he was a false man, the ulema of India, all of them together, were they not enough to destroy him? Why did he escape? If he was a false man, the Christians of India and the Christian empire of Great Britain, was it not sufficient to destroy him? Because he had annoyed them enough. He had claimed that their God was dead. The Muslim masses and the ulama could not forgive him, I mean mashayikh could not forgive him, because they had declared Jesus to be dead. But Jesus was a prophet to them. How could this claim be pocketed by the British Empire and the Christians that their God is dead? Could you consider a greater affront to the honor and visage of the British Empire and the Christians? They could not. So why this single man, unaided by any group in the world, rose from power to power and strength to strength, and he was always proved right that you will not be able to confine me. You know, the claims were made, counterclaims, by Hindus, not only by Muslims, by Hindus as well, by Christians. This man can put up a show for a while in Qadian, but he will be buried and destroyed along with his movement. Nothing will be heard of him after a few days. Those who claimed, nothing is heard of them. Only we tell the people about who they were. Otherwise they are buried under the dust of history. His name is being lauded and respected by more and more people and more nations of the world. So what sort of God that was, who said, if Muhammad Rasulullah told lies against me, then I'll destroy him. If others did, I don't care. Can you believe in such a God? So this is the conclusion to which I was coming, and you spoke too early. Now if you want to ask anything, I rest my case, and please.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. First, we're coming to this, what you say in the verse, starting the translating, that Sayyidina Salih alayhi salam, he told us be a liar, when he started to translate of yesterday.
It was Jesus Christ who was supposed to be alive, but he is not alive.
He said that you said that Salih, he turned to be alive.
I never said that.
He said, and he's just translating. You bring the first. And
all right, if he has
we
did
get it,
it
afterwards.
He, if he did it,
we record
he apologizes it. For that mistake and corrects himself. Do it. Tell them.
لقد قال لي الأخ أبو حسين أنني أخطأت في الترجمة في بداية البرنامج وقلت على أن سيدنا صالح عليه الصلاة والسلام ظهر في آخر الأمر على أنه كاذب. هذا ما قلته.
هيون. Did you say?
No, كاذب. He turned to be a liar.
I said liar.
Liar.
No. I said people believed him to be a liar, not he.
Yes.
This is a mistake. I said the people of his own people believed him to be a liar.
No, he said he turned it to be a liar in this.
No question.
Maybe he said
if
that.
If he says that, consciously he'll become a kafir himself.
No, astaghfirullah al-azim. No, that's it.
Oh no, there has to be a mistake somewhere.
All right, we will see to that afterwards.
Okay, please.
We come to the Hadith Sharif, which Your Eminence said that Rasul Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ana khatim al-anbiya. أنا علي خاتم الأولياء
وأنت يا علي
وأنت يا علي خاتم الأنبياء same. I have reasoned this question with two of Muslim scholars from Al-Azhar and to find out about this hadith, because if it's not correct, because if I have to correct it in my own way, that there's so many wali coming after Ali.
That's right.
Hundreds or thousands, you see. Yeah. So how can Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say that he is the last one, last wali when he came after that Muhammad, a'udhu billah, was telling lies?
That's right. Yes.
So when I ask them about this question, they say, there is no question, there is no such hadith in any of Sahih. If you ask about, right, if there is a proof that this hadith is, because there is so many Israelite hadith,
right,
against Rasul. And if we come to the, if we don't have the proof,
that's right,
that Rasul Karim say this thing, everybody say that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa la'azhu billahi is a liar.
I'll come to that. I understand. The point I raised was,
yeah,
that none of the Muslim scholars of earlier times rejected this hadith on the basis that it is contradictory to the claim of Rasulullah sallam, so it can't be accepted. None of Muslim eminent scholars rejected this hadith on this basis. This is found in Tafsir al-Kafi.
Al-Kafi?
Al-Kafi, yes.
Of the Shia?
Of the Shias.
Yeah.
Also it is found in Sunni books. You have got?
Yes.
Bring the reference.
Yes.
We'll give you the reference. Yeah,
because Al-Kafi is written by, they say written by Hadhrat Ali, and Tafsir, all Muslim scholars say no, it's not true. No,
what I mean to say is,
we I'm here to find out.
Please, just a minute.
So please don't take me wrong.
I don't take
because
you wrong, but you will, give me time.
Yes, I give you time. Even tomorrow, after tomorrow, I will keep coming
what
until
I mean
we find
to
out the
see,
truth.
What I mean to say is that this hadith is found in Muslim literature, both the Sunni and the Shia. It is not in the Sahih Sitta. I claim, I accept it. I'm not debating the issue. I accept it is not found in Sahih Sitta.
Uh-huh.
But at the same time, this was not made by Ahmadis. This hadith is there in the Muslim literature for around a thousand years or thereabout.
Who made this literature?
Muslim scholars of old. They reported this hadith. We'll give you.
No, their names are there.
The brief reference is here. Tafsir Safi, Surah Ahzab.
Kafi.
Safi. Sharah Kafi, Tafsir Safi. Yes, yes. Tafsir al-Safi, Surah Ahzab.
Surah al-Ahzab.
Yes.
What verses and what page?
The same Khatm al-Anbiya.
Khatm al-Anbiya.
Uh-huh. It's there.
In
but there are other references. I will bring other references. This hadith is found not only here but elsewhere with a difference. But the difference does not make any difference in the issue which we are discussing. In one report, it is said, Ahadu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, wa anta khatamul asfiya, instead of khatamul awliya. In the other, it is said, anta khatamul awliya.
Awliya or asfiya,
it's
the
same
thing.
That's what I'm
saying. You safi, you are wali.
Exactly. That's what
you're clean.
Exactly. The point I made, which you missed to note, was this, that we did not invent this hadith. Previous Muslim scholars have reported it as having been said by Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah. This is correct.
Yeah,
this we can prove.
Who's the proofiest?
Now, if it is not Sahih, why did not Sahih? The word Sahih can be understood in two ways.
Yeah.
Number one, the line of narrators was not complete. Those who narrated the hadith, in that line, either there was a break or one of the narrators was not trustworthy. So such ahadith are rejected as gharu sahih, right? But I did not mention that part. I said if the subject of this hadith was not acceptable, there should be at least some ulama in the past who should have objected to the subject matter of hadith.
We say that in the past, those ulama have changed the history of Islam. Most of them, they say, think was not right.
What I'm saying,
don't
saying,
take their thing or their literature.
Follow. Please don't follow. Try to follow me.
I will.
What I'm saying is that if this hadith, in its subject matter, was not acceptable to the earliest Muslims, why didn't they object to the subject discussed in this hadith? Why didn't they say it is impossible for Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to have said this about Hazrat Ali, because this would mean that there would be no Wali after him or no Safi after him. None of them discussed this. None, which means they were not against the subject. They only discussed it from the point of view of its reporting. The reporting could be weak, but the subject was never challenged. Well, it's up to you to agree or not, but I have explained.
I'm not sure I agree or not. I don't accept this explanation. Maybe these people...
Yes, you may not.
You said the Muslim scholar, okay. The first.
If it
who are they? What their names?
We'll give you.
All right.
But what I'm going to
when
say...
When I first come here, I say I come to find out
facts. So please,
don't offend him.
No, I'm not offended.
Give me a chance.
I am.
I have plenty of time. We are alive. We are together to discuss it in a Muslim way.
Interfere.
We're not going to fight each other. You tell me the right way. I follow it.
Interfere the flow of my argument. You have forgotten that this is not the only thing which I had said to explain the meaning of Khatam. I had said other things. Why haven't you touched them?
I haven't seen them, I haven't listened to them.
I have spoken. I said, you can lift the Diwan of Mutanabbi and you see written over it, Khatam al-Shu'ara.
Mutanabbi is a Sha'ir, Magnon or anything, we can call him anything.
No. Arabs were saying it. Arab scholars used the word Khatam, not to mean the last, but to mean the greatest. This is what I have
proved.
The greatest.
The greatest?
Yes. The greatest of poets, Mutanabbi, Khatam al-Shu'ara. The greatest of Atibba, Bu Ali Sina, Khatam al-Atibba. The greatest of wise men is referred to by the Arabs as Khatam al-Hukama.
Greatest in Arab means
Khatam.
A'zamhum. A'zam al-Shu'ara.
But also Khatam.
Aqwa al-Shu'ara. Aqwa al-Atibba.
I agree.
But not.
Is there only one word for the greatest?
Khatam.
Yeah. The word Khatam has been used by the Arabs to indicate the greatest.
In which dictionary?
552.
Some examples.
Here, look at this. A list of 50 usages by the Arabs and other great Muslim scholars which have used the word in the sense not of the last, but in the sense of greatest. Look.
Is in Arabic? Arabic language?
No, but he will translate it. We'll translate this and provide you the list. No problem.
Please.
Abu Tamam Shair is called Khatam al-Shu'ara of Yatul Ayan Jild Awal, first volume. Abu Tayyib is also called Khatam al-Shu'ara Muqaddama Diwanul Mutanabbi Misri, is published in your country, Egypt. Page 15. Abu al-Ala al-Mu'arri is also mentioned as Khatam al-Shu'ara in the same reference which has been quoted. Sheikh Ali Hazin, who was called Ali Hazin, was a Persian poet. He was given the title of Khatam al-Shu'ara. Read in Hayat-e Sadi, page 117. Habib Shirazi of Iran was also referred to as Khatam al-Shu'ara. Read Hayat-e Sadi, page 87. Hazrat Ali al-Khatam al-Awliya. Read Tafsir-e Safi, Surah Azab. Imam Shafi, Khatam al-Awliya, At-Tuhfatu Sunniya, page 45. They are not things concocted by us. That, just a minute. Arabs, great Arab scholars have used this word.
We could say that this Khatam in their own country or Sheikh, in their own district.
Sheikh Ibn al-Arabi Khatam al-Awliya, Sarwaraq Futuhat al-Makkiya, Ibn Arabi. Imam Muhammad Abduhu Misri, Khatam al-Aimma, Tafsir al-Fatiha, Safa, page 148. As-Sayyid Ahmad As-Sanusi, Khatamatul Mujahideen, Akhbarul Jamia al-Islamiyah, Palestine, 27 Muharram, 1354. Ahmad bin Idris, Khatamatul Ulama'il Muhaqqiqin, Al-Uqdun Nafis. Abu al-Fadl al-Ulusi, Khatamatul Muhaqqiqin, Sarwarq, Tafsir Ruhul Ma'ani. Shaykh al-Azhar, Salim al-Bashari, Khatamul Muhaqqiqin, Al-Harab, page 372. Imam Suyuti, Khatamatul Muhaqqiqin, the title page, Tafsir Itqan. Hazrat Shah Waliullah Dehlavi, Khatamul Muhaddisin, Ujala Nafia, volume 1st. Al-Sheikh Shamsuddin, Khatamatul Huffaz, At-Tajreed As-Sari, Muqaddama, page 4. Khatamul Tazkiratul Awliya writes, the greatest of the Wali is called Khatamul Awliya. So what I said, this is supported by Tazkiratul Awliya. Then Futuhul Ghaib mentions, a man who continues to rise in the sight of Allah gradually reaches the status of Khatamul Awliya. Then Ash-Shaykh Najib is called Khatamatul Fuqaha, Akhbar As-Siratul Mustaqim, 27 Rajab, 1354. Shaykh Rashid Raza was called Khatamatul Mufassirin, Al-Jamiatul Islamiyah, 9 Jamadi Usani, 1354.
Yes, it's
more recent, more to come.
Yeah, it's too much, you know.
No, not time. Too much. You wanted more, so I will give you more.
No, we'll come to the hadith.
Al-Sheikh Abdul Haq, I have already dealt with that.
Yes.
That Safi, I have given you the reference.
Which Safi?
Tafsir Safi.
Tafsir Safi?
Yes. Tafsir Safi.
Yeah, but
we'll show you. We'll present. Yeah, present the coffee. No problem. Yeah. Don't interrupt me.
In this country, as I say,
don't interrupt me.
To proof, I'm not interrupting you. Just want to find out.
Sheikh Abdul Haq Khatamatul Fuqaha, Tafsir al Iqlil, Sheikh Muhammad Najib Khatamatul Muhaqqiqin, Waliyo Khatamul Walaya, Muqaddama Ibn Khuldun or Khuldun.
Ibn Khuldun.
Shah Abdul Aziz Khatamul Muhaddisin al Mufassirin. Hadayat al-Shia, Khatam al-Makhlukat al-Jismaniya is man. Tafsir al-Kabir, Jild 6, 24, I mean volume 6, Imam Razi has written this. Al-Sheikh Muhammad bin Abdullah Khatamatul Huffaz, Ar-Rasail al-Nadira, page 30. Allama Saaduddin Tuftazani Khatamatul Muhaqqiqin, Shara Hadith al-Arba'in. Ibn Hajar Asqalani Khatamatul Huffaz, Tabaqatul Mudallisin, Sarwara. Maulvi Muhammad Qasim Nanotmi, Khatamul Mufassirin, Asrar-e-Qurani, title page. Imam Suyuti has mentioned, again, Khatamatul Muhaddisin fi Hadiyatul Shia. Hazrat Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is also mentioned in Hujjatul Islam as Khatamul Kamilin. Hazrat Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is Khatamul Maratib, all the stages of nearness to God are Khatam in him, all the stages. This is said in Ilmul Kitab, page 140. Isa alayhi salam is also referred to in Baqiyatul Mutaqaddimin as Khatamul Asfiya al-Aimmah. Hazrat Ali, Khatamul Awsiya fi Manar al-Huda. This is the second book which I told you about.
Yes.
Manar al-Huda, 106, page 106. So one is from Shah Safi, the other reference is from Manar al-Huda. Musannif Allama Muhammad Sibtin has written about Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah Sallam that he is also Khatamul Muallimin. Is that he was the last of Muallimin? Al-Shaykh al-Suduq is called Khatamul Muhaddis, Khatamul Muhaddisin Kitab Man La Yahziruhu al-Faqih. Imam Razi says that man's wisdom is Khatam, Khatam of all wisdom. This is written in Tafsir Kabir Razi, Jild, Volume 6, page 31. Abul Fazl Shahab al-Ulusi is Khatamul Udaba, Ruhul Mani. Sahib-e Ruhul Mani has referred to Ash-Shaykh Ibrahim al-Qurani as Khatamatul Mutaakhirin. Maulvi Anwar Shah Kashmiri in India has been called Khatamul Muhaddithin. This list goes on until Sheikh Sadi also is referred as his book Firdausi, Shahnam Firdausi, is referred to as the Khatamul Kutub. After that there is no kitab. Hadhrat Mawlvi Muhammad Qasim Nanotvi I have referred to earlier. Mawlvi Shabir Ahmed Usmani, this is a long reference, I leave it. Hadhrat Maulana Rum.
Hadhrat Maulana Rumi. Ibn Rumi.
You know what he says? Behri Khatam Shudas U ke Bajud. Misle U Ne Bhud Ne Khahan Bhud. He is Khatam. Why? Because like him never was, and like him will never be. This is the meaning of Khatam. Someone who excels in qualities, to be single, left alone, there is no comparison. This is the meaning of the greatest. Now these 50 usages I have mentioned are from all great earlier scholars in Islam. Did they not understand the meaning of Khatam? Now, I can tell you, you can put it to test yourself today, now. Yes. I once, at the University of London, translated a sentence which was to be translated from English to Arabic, which said that that Khalifa of Banu Umayya was the last caliph of Banu Umayya. Remember, Khalifa so-and-so, whoever it was. I was, like other students, were to translate this sentence. So-and-so was the last of the caliphs of Banu Umayya. You know how I translated it? I said, Kana Khatam al-Khulafai min Banu Umayya. And the professor put a red line across. Said, you're wrong. I said, no, I'm right. He said, how? I know Arabic more than you. I said, God, according to you, knows Arabic more than everybody else. And according to you, he has used the word Khatam in the meaning of last. So why don't you cut that verse of the Holy Quran again? Then I knew, of course, what I meant. It was an argument on the style of Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. So I went to other Arab students and said, look here, he is our professor, he doesn't know Arabic. And they looked at me, you know, looked down. What do you mean he doesn't know Arabic? I said, he told me to translate, so and so was the last of the caliphs of Banu Umayya, and I translated it as, he was the Khatamul Khulafa min Banu Umayya. And he said, no, wrong.
He was right, I think. And he was wrong.
Who was
because
right?
Khatam ibn Umayyah Khulafa was Amir al-Mu'mineen Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. The last Khalifa of Ibn Umayyah. Yeah, was the last one.
No.
Yes, who after him?
What do you mean?
Al-Khalifa al-Khamis. Bani Umayyah.
Ismail was after him.
Who's Ismail?
Khalifa after him.
After Umar ibn Abdul Aziz?
Yes.
Ismail what?
Ismail who sent, in fact, the expedition to India for the conquest of India.
Those who, Ismaili section, follow him.
He is from Banu Umayya. Please read the history of Banu Umayya and then confront me again, please.
I'm not confronting you.
No, you are, but let me. Mildly, but you are.
I sit in front of you, yeah. But not challenging you.
If this is not challenging, what is? No, I said he was not the last of Banu Umayyah's Khulafa, and you said he was. Hadrat Umar bin Abdulaziz was not the last of the Khulafa'i Bani Umayyah. He happened right in the beginning, not in the beginning but somewhere. After him, other Khulafa of Bani Umayyah did come. And yet, he is called Khatam al-Khulafa, according to him. So, what I'm saying is, you don't avoid this, please understand. What I'm saying is this, that when you say he is the last of the kings of that dynasty, you can never translate it as Khatam. Why not? Abu Zafar Bahadur, the last king of England, India, Mughal king, he can never be referred to as the Khatam al-Salatin al-Mughliya. Because the Arabs don't use it in this sense. The Arabs use the word Khatam to pay compliment. And again, you have forgotten all the other arguments which I presented from the Holy Quran. No. If the Khatam word Khatam meant no prophet after him, when why did God forget about it? Why did he said, وَمَنْ يُتَئِ اللَّهَ وَالرَّسُولَهُ فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَا الَّذِينَ مِنَ النَّبِيِّينَ
وَالصِّدِّيقِينَ
وَحُسْنُ أُولَٰئِكَ. And you forgot that?
No, I don't
you
forget that.
You took a hadith in which there was a weak point of narration and you are building all your argument on that hadith? Leave it. Forget about it. But what about the Quran? When it says, يَا بَنِي آدَمَا إِمَّا يَاتِيَنَّكُمْ رُسُلٌ مِّنْكُمْ. Was it the word of the same God who said Khatam al-Anbiya? Why did he contradict himself? If Khatam means the last, how could the same God tell the rest of the world, not only the Muslims, Ya Bani Adama, Imma Yati Yannakum, Rusulum Minkum, Yaqussuna Alaikum Ayati. Why don't you understand? Then the same God, as I have told you, addressing the Muslimin, the Muttabayin Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah Sallam, says, وَمَنْ يُتَئِ اللَّهَ وَالرَّسُولَ فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَا الَّذِينَ أَنْهَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ مِنَ النَّبِيِّينَ. Why not remove the title Nabiyeen? If this was not an award to be given to the followers of Muhammad Rasulullah Sallam. So Khatam means, if it means last, it only means last of the law-bearing prophets. The last whose word will carry through to the generations till the end of the time. Under him, subordinate to him, prophets could come. And if you have an argument against these two verses, first discuss them. Then we'll come to this hadith. And even if we leave it alone, it does not make the slightest difference to our cause, because the whole Arab usage has been presented to you.
It seemed that you was a little bit upset.
Of course, I was upset.
No, I'm
because
not.
Because you started challenging.
No, not challenging
the validity and the truth of what I was saying. You doubted the references.
No, I'm doubting so the hadith.
So, all right, leave all those references alone. Chuck to whatever you like this list of the Arab usage. Come to the usage of the Quran. How can you deny that?
I can deny nothing in the Quran. No, impossible.
So I have given two references from the Quran. Two references, not one. One says, Ya Bani Adama, Imma Yatiyannakum Rusulum Minkum. This is known as Saqila. It applies to the future.
Yeah.
The future in relation to Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah Sallam. What is the meaning of this? When Khatam means no prophet can ever come, whatever. Then what is the meaning of Man Yuta Illah wa Rasulah?
You could say the Khatam as well in Arabic translation, that nobody will come will be the same as him.
This is what I said, and you rejected.
No, I didn't reject it.
No, I said this is the greatest. You said no, it doesn't mean the greatest. You rejected. This is what I've said already. The greatest is the one whose like of him is not born.
Oh, nobody will come like him.
Yes.
That means
Hadrat Muhammad Rasulullah is not equal to him.
Is not equal to him.
Not at all.
Him is not prophet like him.
No. Huh? No, he is not a law-bearing prophet. He has not brought a new book. The only book he believes is the book, the Holy Quran. The only word he follows is the word of Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah. So he is the one who is mentioned. وَمَنْ يُطَعِ اللَّهَ وَالرَّسُولَ فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَا الَّذِينَ أَنَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ.
You and me and everybody will ta'a Allah wa Rasul will be.
But من النبيين.
من النبيين.
والصديقين. والشهداء. والصالحين.
والصالحين.
So we could be from
everybody.
Everybody.
صالح and me صالح.
That is right. But everybody can't be Nabi. Huh? Everybody can't be Nabi.
After this.
That means after Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah. Who can follow him before him? Everyone mentioned here is to be born after him. And whoever follow him can be awarded by Allah the title of Nabuwat. If not, why is it mentioned? Think over it and come tomorrow.
Inshallah. I hope he don't upset. I'm not challenging.